Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Well, I'm going to go ahead and keep digging a little bit deeper on my subjects that I've been on the last two or three teaching snippets. Yesterday, I talked about the Eastern Orthodox Christianity and just gave a background of that because many times what I find is we don't really understand where some of the beliefs that are out there, where people get that, and we jump the gun, okay, and we accuse them of being heretics or false teachers. I know I get a lot of grief from people when I teach something outside of the permissive, what we've been given permission to believe, outside of our American churches or our certain denominational boxes that we seem to get put into and don't even realize that we have been put into that box. So I really wanted to give a background about the Eastern Orthodox Christianity because this is actually their belief, the Eastern Orthodox Christians, is the most ancient beliefs about Jesus and what his Father, our Father now, our God, wanted to do with humanity. This is not some new wave thing or some heretic thing that some little small group came up with. No, this is actually the oldest roots to Christianity that ties right back into the original 11 disciples as well as Paul, going all the way back to what Jesus taught. Now, I think it's worthy of me saying this again. The Eastern Orthodox Christians, okay, there's around, I believe I said yesterday, there's 260 million who are Eastern Orthodox Christians, which is quite a bit more than we have here in the United States who call themselves Protestant Christians, which is around 143 million. So there's a whole lot more people around the world that actually believe Eastern Orthodox doctrines than what we think we know here in the United States. Our belief system that we have here in America in our Western churches came from Rome, the Latin-speaking group of people, okay, Roman Catholic Church, okay? And what we believe here in America is directly in line with what the Roman Catholics teach and believe, okay, their doctrines. The Eastern Orthodox Church has not changed their doctrines over time. Their roots go all the way back to Jesus, the original disciples, and Paul. Here's something we have to remember. The Eastern Orthodox Church has always read a Greek Bible, whether it's the Old Testament or the New Testament. We, on the other hand, here in America, we are reading a translation of a translation from different places that did not originate through the original Greek text. It's worthy of me saying this today also is that the majority of the New Testament, most Bible scholars believe that the manuscripts, and they have lots and lots of different partial manuscripts that are written in Greek, okay? So Greek was the language that was predominant during the writing of the New Testament, okay? So I wanted to talk a little more about that because I made some notes because I want to make sure I try to stay on point. So I want to talk to you a little about this. Here it is. These are my notes that I wrote today, and I put down, I wanted others to understand the source of the doctrines of purification and reconciliation. Okay, so purification, where people will be purged and purified and cleansed of wickedness through a process of purification by God, and got the doctrine of total or universal. I don't really like using that word because people automatically go off into a negative idea because universalists sometimes don't include the power and the blood and the redemption of Jesus. But it's an absolute, complete, total reconciliation and restoration of all things. That's all things, all people, all things, the earth, the animals, everything will be restored to its originality from the garden before the fall of Adam. So, but let me keep reading here. Many Christians in America have a knee-jerk reaction to anything that is different from what their church denomination has taught them to believe. They go into an attack mode and start name-calling instead of asking questions and researching on their own. And that's why I wanted to give you an understanding about the history of and the roots to the Eastern Orthodox Christian doctrines about that there isn't a hell, because hell has never been translated and put into their Greek Bibles, okay? They're still using the original Greek scriptures, so their Bibles have not been changed. And look, I'm not saying anybody intended to do anything wrong. I'm just saying many times things are lost in translation and even changed because over time and culture, meanings change. I'm going to give you a quick example about that. Within 50 years ago, not even 50 years, okay, if I said, I went to Mary's house and it's really cool, 50 years ago, people would think that I needed to wear a sweater to stay warm. Today, we believe that means Mary's house is decorated pretty nice, or it's what is in style in our time period, okay? So, see, language and words change meanings over time. So, you know, if you go all the way back to Jesus, the 11 disciples, and Paul, and what they wrote and what they believed, now we're getting really, really close to what Christianity is supposed to be all about. And unfortunately, after the Roman Catholic leaders who speak Latin got a hold of some of our Bibles, and translated it, that's where we kind of get off having some Bibles that have mistranslated words like eternal, and that word eternal means of the age, for a time period. And then, of course, the word judgment. Many times the word judgment just simply means correction. And then, of course, we have the problem with the word hell that was not in the Bibles, in any Bible, until the 5th century when St. Augustine started teaching the idea of eternal conscious torment in a place called hell. Okay, when all along what the Greek-speaking Eastern Orthodox churches believed is that people would go through a correction for a set period of time according to what they needed to be purified through that process, but it was never an eternal punishment in hell, okay? So what I want to do today, from this point, okay, I've read my notes. What I want to do is, I told you that I had these different, and I've just got my short list printed out, but I have a list of close to 120 scriptures that help us prove out and see why the Eastern Orthodox Church or the Christians, Eastern Orthodox Christians, have always believed that God would reconcile all of mankind back to himself, and none would be lost, as well as that there would be a purification, not an angry God punishing people to get even with them in a lake of fire or in hell. So what I think I want to do today, I pulled up some scriptures and I just want to read these to you. And this is Psalms 65:2, and this is in the Young's Literal. This is a literal translation of that language. It says here that, O hearer of prayer, talking to God, that he hears all prayers, all flesh shall come to you. And I like that translation because it says, to thee all flesh cometh. But what it says in the original Hebrew scripture of Psalms, it says that, O God, the one who hears prayers, all flesh will come to you. Okay, the next scripture that I want to read to you right here is in the Disciples' Literal New Testament, and this is Luke chapter 3, verses 5 through 6. Every valley will be filled, and every mountain and hill will be made low, and the crooked paths will become straight, and the rough will become smooth paths. Now here's verse 6. all flesh, will see the salvation of God. See, it doesn't say certain people or small groups of people or just people in America who believe certain things and we are members of certain churches and denominations. No, right here it says that all flesh. Did you know that in the Old Testament it talks about flesh, and that relates to animals as well as human beings? So all flesh, all of God's creation is going to see the salvation of God, which is brought to us through Jesus. Here's John 17:2, okay? And it says, just as you have given him, Jesus, authority over all flesh, in order that as to all that you have given him, that he may give eternal life to him, to them. Now, here's what I want to show you right here in this passage. It says give eternal life to them. Did you know that word eternal wasn't actually what was in the original Greek? Let me read you what was in the original Greek out of the Young's literal translation. According to thou didst give to him, being Jesus, authority over all flesh, that all that thou hast given to him, he may give to them life, age, during. So God gives Jesus all flesh so that all flesh can be given life throughout the ages, age after age after age. Pretty interesting study when you start studying the different ages of God, and that's a different teaching, so let me keep going. But Jesus, God gave Jesus, the Father gave Jesus, authority over all flesh so that Jesus himself could give life to all flesh. That's what John 17:2 is saying. Let's go on down to 2 Corinthians 5:15. And he, Jesus, died for all so that the ones living might no longer be living for themselves, but for the one having died and been raised for them. Now I'm going to read this to you in the Young's and this one also. And for all he died, and those living no more to themselves may live, but to him who died for them and raised again. Now watch, I want to read it one more time. And for all Jesus died, that those living no more to themselves may live, but to him who died for them and was raised again. And did you know this is not talking about specifically just believers, because we have another scripture that says God tasted death for all men. That's Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. Now let me go on down to 2 Corinthians 5:19. How that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. The world, not certain people, not a segment of the world, but the entire world was reconciled to God through Jesus. Watch. And here, I'm going to keep going, not counting their trespasses against them, and having placed the message of reconciliation to us. Okay, the next scripture that I want to go down to, and you know, when I started studying the Eastern Orthodox doctrine of total, absolute reconciliation, restoration of all things, this scripture, when I read it, I thought, how in the world have I read this scripture over and over again and had this religious veil over my eyes and not seen this before? It just jumps out at me. Now, let me read that to you. This saying is trustworthy and true and full of acceptance, for we are laboring and struggling for this, because we have put our hope upon the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of believers, be commanding and teaching these things. That is just an amazing scripture to me, because right there, Paul is very clear. God has saved and reconciled through Jesus, his Son, all men, all mankind, especially us believers. And what that means is that we're already in step with and following Jesus so he can work in and through us right here, right now, and help us grow to be more like him. All people will be saved. They're not all saved right now. And there will be a judgment. There will be a purification. But God's big plan, no matter how many ages it takes for it to happen, it will come to completion. Well, guys, I'm going to sign off. I love you, and I'll see you here tomorrow. Bye-bye.